All right. Good morning, everybody. Want to welcome everyone to Midweek Morning Manna on this rainy Wednesday morning. It's so good to have everybody here today. Thank you guys for being here. I know it takes an effort to get out in a mess like this, and we'll hear it raining on the roof all morning. But we're glad you're here. Thanks for coming. And let's just get started by singing number 44 when we all get to heaven. All right? 44. Here we go now. Let's sing.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and we'll shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sigh. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and we'll shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and we'll shout the victory.
All right, let's turn a few pages to number 54, I'll Fly Away. How about that one? I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, I'll fly away, old glory, I'll fly away in the morning. When I die, by and by, I'll fly away, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have grown up, fly away. Like a bird from prison bars have flown, I'll fly away, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away. Joys will never end. I'll fly away, I'll fly away. Oh, I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. Oh, in the morning, when I die, by and by.
Let's sing that chorus one more time now. I'll fly away. Sing it out like you mean it.
I'll fly away. Oh, glory, I'll fly away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away.
Good job, everybody. 126. 126. Feels like it's been forever since we've been together. I mean, it's just been a couple of weeks, you know, and I missed y'all. I sure did. Last Wednesday, it was, I didn't get out of the house but one time, and that's to go see somebody, and I went right back to the house. It's been a rough week, and when you start, can't go out, and so I know how y'all feel, all right? 126 at the cross.
Alas, and did my Savior plead, and did my sovereign die? Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I? At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. Was it for crimes that I had done? He groaned upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. Oh, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled, it rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away, 'tis all that I can do. Oh, at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart, it rolled away. It was there by faith, received my sight, and now happy all the day.
You know, guys, the cross is the reason Jesus came. That's why he came, to die for our sins. That the cross cost God his very own son. So just imagine what that cross means to us. It ought to mean so, be so special to us today, because it means salvation. If Jesus hadn't have died, if Christ hadn't have come to die in our place, we'd be in trouble, folks. We'd be in trouble. So thank God for the cross. Amen. All right, let's sing number 146, Come and Dine.
Let's sing out, all right. Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people, come and dine. With his manna he doth feed and supplies our every need. Oh, 'tis sweet to sup with Jesus all the time. Come and dine, the Master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine. The disciples came to land, thus obeying Christ's command. For the Master called unto them, come and dine. There they found their heart's desire, bread and fish upon the fire. Thus he satisfies the hungry every time. Come and dine, the Master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine. Soon the Lamb will take his bride to be ever at his side. All the hosts of heaven will assemble be. Oh, 'twill be a glorious sight. All the saints in spotless white, and with Jesus they will feast eternally. Come and dine, the Master calleth, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table, all the will come and dine. He who fed the multitude, turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine.
Very good. Number 152, Invisible Hands. 152, Invisible Hands. There you go, buddy.
Invisible hands are waiting to guide you. Invisible hands will show you the way. Have faith in the Lord. He's always beside you. So pray and believe, and help you. Receive from invisible hands, invisible hands, invisible hands. So pray and believe, and help you receive from invisible hands. Invisible hands will keep you from danger. Invisible hands will keep you from harm. Though you may have sinned, God welcomes a stranger. So pray and believe, and help you'll receive from invisible hands. Invisible hands, invisible hands. So pray and believe, and help you'll receive from invisible hands.
All right, very, very good, everybody. How about number 196? I'm bound for the kingdom. How about that? 196.
You may ask me where I'm headed. You may ask me where I'm bound. Oh, well, I'm going to a country across the sea. And I know I'll have a mansion, and I know I'll have a crown. Well, I'm bound for the kingdom of the free. Yes, I'm bound for the kingdom of the blessed and the free. And my Jesus soon is coming after. There is nothing to compare with all the glory over there. Yes, I'm bound for the kingdom of the free. Well, I'm going to a country where they'll say we'll never die. Will be endless joy and glory there for me. Yes, I know I'll live forever in that city in the sky. Well, I'm bound for the kingdom of the free. Yes, I'm bound for the kingdom of the blessed and the free. And my Jesus soon is coming after me. Compare with the glory over there. Yes, I'm bound for the kingdom of the free.
Very good. I got caught in an awkward position. I got an itch on my back and I couldn't get that note, y'all. Miss Frieda? That's right. We want everybody to have it. All right. We're going to sing one we hadn't sung in a long time. Give me old-time religion, y'all. Give me that old-time religion. 195. Here we go.
Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. It's good enough for me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. It was good for all our mothers. It was good for all our mothers. It was good for all our mothers. It's good enough for me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. It will do when I am dying. It will do when I am dying. It will do when I am dying. It's good enough for me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven. It's good enough for me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me.
And all God's people said, amen. Mr. Peter, you ready? We're ready for you. Thank you, Miss Vicki. Good job. What you going to play today, Mr. Pete? Ciphering, huh? Get them gazintas in there now as you cipher. Beautiful Garden of Prayer. That's a good spot to be today. We need to be in that beautiful Garden of Prayer on this rainy, rainy day. All right.
Thank you.
lost there.
You good, though.
Go ahead.
You ain't going to try it again.
Go ahead. Try it again. Perfect, brother. Good job. Good job. First mistake you ever made, y'all. That's pretty good. How old are you? 83, 84? Oh, you just learned to play it. Okay, that's pretty good. That's just not bad, my friend. That's pretty good. First mistake you ever made and made it this long in life. Well, I'm telling you, he's ahead of the game. But we're so glad you're here this morning. I want to run a few things by you real quick, continue to pray for some folks and ask the Lord to be with them. A young lady by the name of Tabby Crockett, we've been asked to pray for her. If you want to remember Dave Smith and his family, we buried Miss Ruth yesterday. Prayed for their family and asked the Lord to be with them. Miss Heather Lou Allen, Miss Brenda Bennett, they're both got to come home and continue to pray for their healing. She's on dialysis, and Brenda, her back is still, they're trying to continue to get her to get better. So pray for her. Mr. Dennis Farmer had to go back to the hospital over the weekend, got to come home yesterday. So pray for Mr. Dennis and ask the Lord to be with him. Miss Loretta Owings is still having some intestinal issues, and pray for her. Kent Pieri, he's just really having a hard time with that thumb. So pray for Kent and Miss Cherie. A good friend of mine named Doc Alphen, he's asked for prayer. Miss Gloria is better. She was getting, I think, going to be moved into the rehab area either yesterday or today. Continue to pray for Miss, was that right? Good, yesterday, good. I thought Mr. Billy McCreeless, keep Billy in your prayer. Mr. Richard McMillan. Miss Betty's daughter, Beverly Reddick, had a seizure maybe. They're not really for sure what happened, but she was in St. Bernard's. I visited with them on Monday, and so keep them in your prayers and remember them in your prayers. Miss Olivia Cornett, she's better. She's in getting a better stage. Continue to pray for Mom. Mom's surgery is Friday morning, so pray for her. And then I got word last night that Mr. Larry Warren, that's Francis Warren's husband, he passed away last night. And so we'll be having a funeral for him. She called me about 10 o'clock last night. He fell and broke a hip. He was in the nursing home at Campbell and fell and broke a hip, and it just kind of went faster and faster. So keep him in your prayers. Anybody else we need to remember in prayer this morning? Anybody? On your mind? All right, Ricky said Gary wasn't feeling well, so pray for Gary. Leave him in your prayers. And again, pray for folks that are traveling on the roads today. It's awful slippery and ugly out there, so y'all be careful. And remember Miss Judy. Miss Judy's not been feeling well, but she's better today. Isn't that right, Granny? Granny said so. All right. Well, let's have a word of prayer. Let's ask the Lord to be with. Father, we love you. What a blessing it is to be here this morning. Thank you so much to bring us back here to your house together with our Manna family. We just ask that you'd be with us in a really special way. Thank you for these wonderful old songs that mean something to us in our heart. I pray that you just bless and Father, use that today. Lord, use the teaching of the Word of God and an explanation of it, of David and the trials that David faced in his old life. And we just pray that you'd bless our time together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Take your Bibles and turn to Psalms 35 this morning. Psalms 35. And Dr. Phillips uses this title to this psalm, When a Friend Becomes a Foe. When a friend becomes a foe. And he goes back to when King Saul was David's friend, because David, as a young man, remember, killed the giant. You know, he'd offered a reward, and nobody would step forward to kill the giant. And David said, man, how come somebody ain't done something yet? And he was somebody, so he went to do something and took a smooth stone, put it in his slingshot, hit that rascal, and fell right, just hit him right here in the middle of the head, fell dead. And the Israeli army went nuts, crazy, jumping up and down. And the Philistines, they went everywhere. They just scattered because their giant had went down. And so, but that point in time, Saul was a friend. But later on, because of David's prowess as a military might and a military mind, Saul turned on him, and he turned on him in a big way. And so he tried to kill him, even at court, and he tried to kill him. So I see the results of this. The Bible speaks about, if you've got a study Bible, mine says the Lord is the avenger of his people, and this is a psalm of David. And so we look for this psalm of David as David begins to share with us these wonderful words from the Lord. And as we began, he talks about the warrior, David the warrior. And guys, I when I was thinking about this morning in my quiet time, was thinking about all of us are warriors in a sense, spiritual warfare. We're all in a battle. We're all in some very trying moments in this world, in our spiritual walk against the world. Jesus tells us, and John writes, he says, we're to be in the world but not of the world. We're to live here and to make a stand and make a difference. And I think those days will even become more understanding in the years to come. None of us have probably ever had a gun pointed at us and tells us you need to renounce Christ or die. But I read in a book of martyrs about every morning in my quiet time about these young men that's being asked by the radicals, renounce Christ or die. And I think, oh my goodness, you know, what a terrible thing to have to order. And that happens every day somewhere in the world. And so our missionaries face those trials. And when they get to, people become radical in their thinking. And you know, I wish that we, in a sense, would be radical for Jesus like that, to the point that we wanted people to be saved. And Ms. Frieda made, in her testimony, said that she wanted people to be saved. Want everybody to go to heaven. We do. But how important is that? When we love somebody and we don't tell somebody about that, it's really important. We need to make sure that we do that. So we're kind of a warrior like David in this old world. It's a battle, and it's a trial, and so as I think about that, I think about how that David asked God, if you will, to do some things for him. In the first three verses of this chapter, he asked God to defeat his enemies. He said, Lord, you need to defeat my enemies. Please defeat my enemies. You know, without the Lord, we're just spinning our wheels. Without the Lord, we're just spinning our wheels. And I think David realized that. He understood that. As from a young boy all the way up through his life, even when he messed up, even when he did wrong, he knew that without the Lord, I'm nothing. I'm nobody, and I'm never going to get ahead in this old world to understand that. So as David writes, he begins to share with us, and he makes a cause, and he is a warrior in these few verses that we begin this chapter with. And it says, plead my cause, if you will. Plead my cause, O Lord, with those who strive with me. There's a battle going on. There's a battle. Fight against those who fight against me. Take hold of the shield and buckler and stand up for my help. He says, and also draw out the spear and stop those who pursue me. Say to my soul, I am your salvation. So David made it very plain and very clear that he calls on God to go to battle for him. That's who we all are when we go to battle. I put some families on the prayer list this morning on the prayer wall in there. And one of the ladies had sent me a text this morning that I text every day. And she said, pray for my sister. And I said, I just put her on the prayer wall. It's in the prayer room. And I'm just so we prayed for her. And we're going to pray for her today. We do a different battle. This is a tremendous battle, maybe the most important battle. And that's a battle that we need to have before God in our prayer life. Very important. One of the most important things. If there's anything that we're going to accomplish in this world, it's got to be the Lord doing and directing it. And when we humble ourselves before him, I see David here as a warrior, as a gallant warrior, but I also see him as a humble servant calling out to God. I see him as a man that goes before the Lord and says, well, I can't do this by myself. And the Lord says, you're right, you can't, let me take care of it. But David calls on him and says, please God, plead my case. Please my cause, O Lord, and with those who strive against me. Fight against those who, if you will, that take a hold of my shield, my buckler. You're my God. You're the one who takes and draw out that spear. Stop those who pursue me. Say to my soul, I am your salvation. There is only one place to go. It's not to Washington. It's not to our government. It's not to any of those things that we hold dear in America. It's not our freedoms. But it's the one who paid for our freedom, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You'll know the truth. The truth sets you free. Sets me free from what? From my bondage of sin. And that's the most valuable warrior, the valuable battle that we fight is the Lord God Almighty. When we ask David, Lord, like David, Lord, please defeat my foes. Defeat my foes. Because as Saul, who was a peer at one point, he was still king, but him and David became on the same level at that point when he defeated Goliath, and they came on that same level, and David went up, and Saul went down, because Saul wasn't trusting in the Lord. David only knew that there was only one trust in the Lord. So guys, we have to remember to be where we need to be. We have to put our trust in the Lord. Whatever the world says, our trust has got to go here. This relationship is most valuable in our own personal walk. Be mindful of that. David cries, Lord, please, if you will, be that warrior in my life. Know that warrior. Know that, God, I've got something for you. We want you to defeat all of our foes. Verse 4. And when he begins to talk about those, he said, not just defeat my foes, but destroy my foes. He says in verse number 4, he said, let those be put to shame and brought to dishonor who seek after my life. Now, we would hope that in our life, that we have a good array of friends. We would have people that would be on our side, so to speak. But folks, that's not always the case, especially if we're standing forth and making a plea before others. Sometimes we have to ask the hard questions. Sometimes the hard questions have to come to us. And I think David here calls out to God on behalf of those who would put him down, on behalf of those who would put his life down. And he cries out, he said, let those be put to shame, Lord, who brought to dishonor, who seek after my life. Lord, be with that and understand that. And so David says, he said, let those be turned back and brought to confusion who plot my hurt. You see, somebody was after David. It was King Saul. And later on in his life, it'd even be his own son. It would even be those warriors who were trying to kill him on behalf of the king, on behalf of Absalom. It would even, so David knew those things, but he knew who to call on. He called on the one who could defeat his foes, but not only defeat his foes, but destroy those foes. He says in verse 5, he said, let them be like chaff before the wind, and let the angel of the Lord chase them. Now, the chaff and the wind, if you will, when they would harvest the grain, they would bring it in, put it in a big pile, and we'd have some folks there be standing up like this, throwing that grain up in the air, and the chaff would be blowing away. The chaff, because it's lighter, and the grain would fall back down. But folks, understand, he says here, Lord, let these, my enemies, be like the chaff. Throw them up in the air, and let the wind take them away. You, God, and you alone can do that. You know, so many times we try to fight our own battles, don't we? So many times we try to do what only God can do. I find that the older that I get, the more that I realize I'm in trouble if I do it on my own. I'm in trouble. So David says, Lord, let the angel of the Lord chase them. He says, let their way be dark and slippery. Let the angel of the Lord pursue them. Now, folks, he talked about an angel. He talked about one of God's choicest men. I read this morning, and I'll read it to you again in Psalms 91. In Psalms 91, where the scripture says, he said, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty in our place of prayer. Wherever that is in your life, I hope you have a place. If it's in your chair, if it's at your couch, if it's in your living room, if it's in your den, wherever it might be. But you have a place of prayer where you can go to God and call on him and cry out to him and know, God, here is my needs today. Here is the things that's going on in my life. Lord, I need some wisdom. I need some guidance. I need some direction. And so David says, Lord, let those folks, my enemies, who he lays over and hands over to him, not just, if you will, come to that place in their life to where his enemies come to be, if you will, pushed aside. Lord, take care of these. Lord, my job is to serve you, and Lord, I need you to clear the path. You know, sometimes we need someone to clear the path for us. That's why it's so valuable. And I ask this, and I truly mean this, on Sundays when I get ready to preach. You don't understand, sometimes you don't understand, people don't understand there is a force, it's an unseen force that fights against your pastor. An unseen force that fights against the man of God who will stand behind the pulpit and proclaim truth. They don't understand that until you're in that battle. And I appreciate people who pray for me when I stand to preach, because I know there's forces all around. There's some Sundays that there's just a lot of distractions in church, aren't they? Just a lot of distractions. And those distractions, whether it be the cute little baby or a kid getting up to go to the bathroom, it's just a distraction. And what does Satan takes those things and magnifies those. And we sat back there but folks, you know, one of the greatest things you could do is on Sundays, before you ever get here to the house of God, before you ever pull on our campus, is to make sure, Lord, this morning, do what only you can do. God, do what only you can do, because it's an unseen battle in the spiritual realm right here. It's an unseen battle that we fight, that we face every day. And so David cries out, he said in verse 6, he said, Lord, let their way be dark, those my foes, my enemies. He said, and let their way be slippery, and let the angel of the Lord pursue them. I think it was Friday, I had pulled my car out of the garage, and I told Lana, I'm going to the hospital in Jonesboro. And she says, aren't you driving your truck? I said, no, I'm going to drive my car today. She said, why? I says, one of them gets 15 miles to the gallon, the other one gets 30 miles to the gallon. Which one would you drive? And she said, okay, I understand. Well, I pull my little car out, I back down the drive, and when I start backing down the drive, the little car just goes whoop, just like that. And when it gets turned sideways, it starts going down forwards, and I'm not even putting a finger, no gas to it. And it stops, and I have a pullout there where you can park there, and it went right there, and that was it. That stopped right there. And so Carrie came out Saturday and helped me pull it out, and we finally got it out, but it was just stuck. It wasn't moving. That's where it had to stay. And, you know, but we think things are slippery, and that ice was very, very slippery. Very, very slippery, and I like to fail down 3 times just getting up to the top, okay? And so we know what it means to think about, Lord, make their way be dark and make their way be slippery. Lord, that's our enemies. That's our foes. Remember that. And so as the angel of God pursues after them, I'm grateful that there's an angel that watches after his children. I'm grateful for that. He says in verse number 7, for without cause they have hidden their net for me in a pit. He said, which they have dug without cause for my life. Now when I thought about, when I read that and studying that, I think about Tarzan. Y'all remember Tarzan, don't you? You used to come on Saturdays. I used to remember Tarzan, and they'd dig a hole, and they would have a net there, and they'd dig that hole, they'd cover it up and camouflage it, and they would run whoever they would run, if it was a lion or something, some kind of animal, or even a person, they'd get down in that hole, and you're stuck. Okay, you ain't going nowhere. And we find that's what we find. They have hidden their net. Satan is always hiding things. He's always pursuing us. He's always trying to make us slip. He's always trying to make us falter and fall down. Satan is always good at that. That's what he does. And so as we think about that today, remember, these folks, they without cause, they have hidden their net, which they have dug a hole or dug without cause for my life. They're trying to do me in, Lord. They're trying to do me in. And he said, let destruction come upon them unexpectedly, and let his net that he has hidden catch himself. Now, you say, Brother Kim, that's a pretty serious prayer right there. It is. But you have to understand, what we're in is a battle. And you know as well as I love to watch history and listen to history and read about history and what we went on in World War II and all the things that happened and all these different battles that were going on. And I'm amazed at how sometimes we just see the unseen hand of the Lord just make this work, or this just happened, or this came right. But you know, there's going to be casualties in war. Not all of us are in a battle. There's going to be casualties. There's going to be men and women falter. They're going to fall down. They're going to be hurt. They're going to be mortally wounded. And what we have to do is come alongside them and love them. And I think that's what David, to me, as I read this, I'm praying that, Lord, show me how I can be of benefit to someone else. Show me how I can serve someone else. And the enemy that's out there, I know he's there. I don't have to guess. The Bible says Satan's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. Satan is always ready to pounce on us. He's always ready to get us. And he uses other things, and other things go on in people's lives. Then he says in the latter part of that verse 8, he says, into that very destruction let them fall. Let my enemies falter. Let them be totally destroyed. Then he says, my soul shall be joyful in the Lord. Why is that? Here's a great part of this. I think this, we talked about how that he wants his foes to be defeated, how that he wants his foes to be destroyed. But as we begin verse 9, now he wants his fears, the fears that he even has in his own life. And all of us have a fear. There's always some fear about what's going on in life. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but I'm thankful that I know who holds tomorrow. We don't know what will happen with this. Well, what if this happens? Well, what if that happens? Well, what if this happens? We don't know that. And you can make yourself worry yourself to death. Y'all can all be out there like me chewing your fingers off, all right? Don't be worrying about that. Don't be worrying about those. It's time to trust in the Lord. But here he says, be joyful in the Lord, and it shall rejoice in his salvation. God's going to do what God's going to do, okay? Remember that. But now he talks about the joy of having Christ, of having our Lord as being our Lord, because he cries out that his fears will, if you will, be dissolved, be just melted away, just melted away. Saturday, the ice was coming off, or Friday and Saturday, the ice was coming off the building, and we had a pretty good puddle of ice out here in front, and Friday morning, I went out and threw some salt on it. As I threw the salt on it, you could just hear it just kind of melting that stuff down. Well, we went, come back out here Saturday and pushed it all off so it would be here so everybody would have a good way to walk and not have a problem with that. Sometimes we have to do some groundwork, okay? Sometimes we have to be prepared before everybody gets here. Understand that. That's very important. I had a fellow the other day share with me. He said, Brother Kim, I didn't know what goes on Sunday mornings until I came to look and see what you guys did. Cole does so much before anybody ever gets here. Every Sunday, every week, and we do things so that you will be ready and prepared and make it as comfortable and blessed as we can for you. Understand that God has already done that for us, spiritually speaking. And he wants us to be in control, if you will, of our situation the best that we can. So we want to ask God, God, dissolve, if you will, dissolve my fears. Because we all have a fear. I don't know what yours is today, but you need to pray this prayer, because in God, in Christ alone, is the only way we're going to get it. He says, my soul will be joyful in the Lord. It shall rejoice in his salvation, not mine, but in his salvation. He says, all my bones shall say, Lord, who is like you? Delivering the poor from him who is too strong for him. I can't beat anybody. God all has going to have to do that for me. And he says in the latter part of verse 10, he says, yes, the poor and the needy from him who plunders him. Now, guys, we all come from different walks of life. But I want you to understand, spiritually speaking, every one of us is poor in spirit. Every one of us is poor in spirit. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. And that's why he beckons every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl to come. I remember one time when we lived in Little Rock, we went to visit a family. A family had come to our church, and we went to visit them the next week. It's in the Chenal Valley area. Beautiful place in Little Rock. Very, very nice homes. Very expensive homes. And people that live there are financially well off, okay? And we was walking up there, and I never will forget, I was looking at my pastor, and I was thinking, now, Bub, I know you, and I know me, and I know our church, and we're just a blue-collar church. And I'm thinking, what do we have to offer these folks? I don't have nothing to offer but Jesus. Amen? It ain't about me. It ain't about him. It ain't about you. It ain't about us. The only thing we have to offer people is Jesus. You can't get any better than that. Say amen. You can't get any better than that. So I'm thankful that we're poor, and we have to understand that we're needy, and we're going to the Lord. Lord, you plunder. You take care of it. I can't do this on my own. Vanish my fears, because we have the joy of the Lord, and then we have the understanding of that he is Lord over all. Then he says in verse 11, fierce witnesses rise up. They ask me things that I don't know. There's sometimes I just have to look at someone and say, I'm sorry, I don't have an answer for that. They reward me evil for good for the sorrow of my soul. David knew these folks. He says, but as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled myself with fasting, and my prayer would return to my own heart. He says, I paced about as though he were friend or brother. I bowed down heavily as one who mourns for his mother. You see, David had a relationship with the Father. He knew who the Lord was. He knew that the Lord had all in his control, and he trusted in him. That's where we are today, y'all. The only answer that I know of, best answer I've ever had, is Jesus. He's the best answer. You want to know who gives peace? Jesus. You want to know who I turn to in the midst of difficulty? Jesus. You know who I need to go to? Because I can't fix it. There's some things I just look at my wife and say, I can't do it. I don't know what to do. I don't have an answer, but God does. And I have to trust him. We have to trust him. Let's remember that we're in a battle. It's a spiritual battle. We're in a war. That's why you read Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 18, Paul talks about putting on the whole armor of God. We need to be ready for battle every day and realize how important that battle is. So this morning, let's think about the foe. Let's think about how we want God to dissolve all of our fears, how that we want our foe to be destroyed by the one who can destroy. We can't do anything about it, but it's God's business. And take care of that. Let's pray. All right, Lord, I love you today. I'm thankful for the Word of God. Lord, I'm thankful that today, in the midst, in the trials of this old world, Lord Jesus, that we will put our trust in you and in you alone. Lord, I'm praying today for every family that's represented here, for those who listen today on social media. Lord, I pray that we would all be, our spiritual antennas would come up, and we'd be heightened to the awareness that, Lord, Satan is our foe. And whether it be a physical foe that we can see or a spiritual foe that, Lord, we don't understand sometimes. God, I pray that you would be Lord over our life. And we thank you for loving us. And we appreciate, Lord, the Word of God today. Help us to be a light into our path. And Lord, help it to illuminate every area of our heart. We love you and we thank you. And so today, Lord, thank you for paying it all. Lord, help us to trust you humbly and come before you in your presence. I love you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's sing, Jesus Paid It All right?
And I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left the crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Thanks, everybody. God bless you. Have a great rest of the week, and be praying for those that we've mentioned. Just ask the Lord to give extra grace and extra strength. Thanks for coming today. We love you. Have a good week. Good night. You're dismissed. Have a good day. Thanks, everybody.